Hey, everybody, on this episode of NSFW, we're joined by Tom Merritt. Tom Merritt's joining us here to talk about 2010. Hey, two thumbs up for Two Thumbs Tom. That's what I like to call him. We're also joined by Michael Rooker, fearsome character actor. Saw him as Merle Dixon on The Walking Dead. He joined us for a very candid conversation, and we discussed his career and how to not pronounce words in an opening tease. It's all coming up on this edition of
I feel like you're stealing my character.
You're getting closer.
Hey,
you're
guys.
Closer.
Let's go.
That was good. Should we do a safety? Should we do a safety?
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for NSFW is brought to you by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This is NSFW episode 56 for December 28th, 2010. A Rooker Looks Back. This extra spectacular episode of NSFW brought to you by Squarespace. Head on over to squarespace.com and sign up for your free, no-risk, two-week trial membership. And make sure to use promo code NSFW to get 10% off the lifetime of your order. And it is go time for a very special, very canned episode of NSFW. As always, I'm your host, Brian Brushwood, joined as always by the inimitable co-host, Mr. Justin Robert Rubles III. How are you, J.R. Weiseth?
I can't believe that the king or the queen was assassinated yesterday.
You know what? I was thinking about that, and I couldn't believe that OMG Chad won the lottery. That
I know. I'm a billionaire. I'm going to go buy a duck now. It's awesome.
He's going to buy. He's got $1 billion from Ebenezer Gerbs.
Yeah.
And he's gonna buy
a
duck.
Buy a duck with it.
That's a duck or something.
Or something.
He did say that he would buy a duck or something. But meanwhile, in his recording studio, rocking out at this very moment, we have the ghosts of Christmas Past, Future, and all the others in between.
Thanks, Dick. We're having a great time out here on the West Coast, getting ready to count down for that ball drop.
Listen, I believe we're cutting over to Justin Robert Young over on the West Coast. I'm sorry, the East Coast. Justin, how is it over on your end? A lot of New Year's excitement going on there, buddy, eh?
You better believe it.
And we're back. So as we're releasing this, we're recording this before Christmas, but you guys are going to see this after Christmas.
Listen, the illusion is spoiled now.
The illusion.
Aren't you supposed to be a magician?
The illusion. Okay, first of all, it's insulting to, don't act like I didn't just, I just crushed your dreams or something, sir.
But you said you had time travel.
Well, I lied, sir, and it's not that New
was,
Year's
that
Eve.
That was just Brian going,
sounded so convincing.
He was waving my fingers all up in your face holes.
That's what I mean. He was waving. It was convincing.
Did I tell you that Bonnie, in a fit of frustration, said to my daughter, "Oh yeah, no, just keep talking. That's what we want to hear. More words from your cry hole."
You didn't tweet that out, but you left her name off it that you've now spoiled.
I'm sorry. But it was the problem is when you read it as cold words, it sounds like she's heartless or whatever, but she clearly meant it as a joke, and it was very funny in the moment.
Did she laugh? Did everyone laugh?
Yes. I mean, Penny just sat there awkwardly unconfused, which is the same as laughter with most kids, if you really think
about it. She didn't come back with a GTFO.
No, yeah. You know what? I'm afraid that's kind of become her little thing that she likes to say. I'm afraid that she doesn't really know what it means and is going to say it on the playground, and I'll be getting a phone call at some point.
Get the frack out.
Well, get the funk on.
Get the funk on, man. Get the funk on, right?
Well, I told Brian, and this is all about, of course, our show last week, which you can go ahead and download on iTunes or twit.tv/NSFW. The way that you know that Penny Brushwood is destined to be a very funny girl is that she understood when she said that Ronald Reagan goes pee in the middle of the backyard.
Right.
That if she just says Ronald Reagan pees in the backyard, funny, like a 5 or 6 funny.
It's the specificity.
That extra 2 points of funny if she points out that it's in the middle of the backyard, the point in which Ronald Reagan pees. It adds that extra sense. Dimension of comedy.
And this is something that we've been terrified from day one, is that our daughter may in fact be funny. Because I can think of nothing more horrible to wish upon a young child.
No,
to grow up
a funny child. Believe me, as a funny child growing up,
right?
I was rejected. I was driven out. You know, the parents made me sleep in the middle of the backyard. Right where Ronald Reagan used to pee.
Exactly. Well, that's how you kept warm, right? You know, the Reagan would come out and warm up your sheets.
And he didn't know he was doing it, but it helped me.
No. The great communicator, really. It's only part of it. It's a full service job.
Okay. Now, here's the thing. I think this is one of the differences between podcasting and traditional media. Traditional media, we totally pretend like
traditional media, too.
Trimissional. It's trimissional.
Transmissional.
It has three missions. It's trimissional media. It's ABC, CBS, and Fox. There is no NBC in trimissional media. So with trimissional media, they try to fool you and make you think like, oh, it's really New Year's Eve. But it's like, no, we're going to tell you this is pre-recorded, and pretty soon you're going to see stuff even older than this. We're going to toss to content that was pre-recorded before this was pre-recorded.
Well, we don't pretend that you're going to sit around and put up with this.
Yeah. We're not being super lazy, though. You know, the fine folks at the Twit Cottage, of course, work to the bone. You know, Tom, you spend, you know, most of your days there at the cottage. You know, they obviously employ child labor that you make live in a mine, not unlike Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom.
No, Justin, they don't live in a mine. It's
okay.
Some people call it a hole in the ground, and that's even a mischaracterization. It's a subterranean dwelling, which has been proven in many green tech episodes to be the most power efficient way of storing your child labor.
No, that's true.
All right. Fair enough.
Every molecule of air accounted for, you know, air in, air out.
You get a lot more insulation from the ground, and you build buildings above ground, and they just leak. They bleed heat out into the world. It's such a waste.
All right, so now that you've been corrected, what was your point about the kids over at Twit?
You know, every once in a while, you gotta let them kind of roam around the grass, you know, maybe throw them a few trinkets to busy themselves. And so that's what's going on right now. Twit the cottage is you know, taking a little bit of break. So we're, instead of having an episode or just an open week.
Oh, no, only the talent get the week off.
Oh, really? Oh, okay. Oh, the kids are still working.
Oh, yeah.
Of course. Oh, okay. Them. Well, that's good. Good to hear. I didn't know that. Yeah. So they're
making Christmas ornaments for us to give out next year.
Oh, thank goodness.
Well, you can never start too early.
Well, and you got to get them early, looking to forge your signature, to actually spell, you know, make it look like you hand wrote.
Yeah, you know, that's
one.
We don't do that anymore. We had a real problem with that getting leaked on WikiLeaks.
Huh? Hey, can we talk about the WikiLeaks things? I don't want to get serious.
No.
too serious.
Well, we can talk about it, but then anyone who works at a government job will have to declare their machine classified if they're watching this show.
Is that a little bit weird to you, the way the reaction, the mass shaming of WikiLeaks? Cut their funding? Like, everyone, like, if you don't get on board, then it's just like, you got trouble. I don't know. It's just weird to me.
Well,
I don't know the details.
Is it really shocking, you know, when you publicly embarrass the government and put into play, you know, people that were, you know, confidential sources that you're going to reap the whirlwind, so to speak?
Right. Well, and that's the thing, is that none of this really happened until the embarrassing stuff came out. None of this happened during the Iraq leaks. None of this happened during the Afghanistan leaks. It only happened after the embassy leaks, which is the most embarrassing stuff. That's when
they no, because that's embarrassing to other people. You know, and you know, there's an old saying that foreign policy doesn't happen until it crosses the Oval Office desk. And if you're going to reveal how they think, you know, and lies we've told, or you know, the things that have gone behind people's backs, then yeah, there's a lot of balls up in the air that WikiLeaks kind of peed all over. So I don't know. I just don't know. I personally don't understand people who are like, whoa, what's happening? Like, of course this guy's going to completely get the shaft on every possible level. Like, what else would anybody expect?
I make a good show on Tech News Today of pretending to be bipartisan, objective, not talk about what's really going on. But, I think between you and me, what's really going on?
It's good because I'm not recording this, and this will not go out publicly.
Yeah, this is the straight dope. Julian Assange is a patsy of the secret world government intelligence bureau. there's a little bit of payback going on. As you look through these leaks, you notice not everybody's leaked about. You know,
yeah,
not every single diplomat. So these guys did something that pretty big that this is payback for. They got to have a setup guy. I mean, let's be honest. Really, an albino Australian is the guy who leaks all of the secrets of the world government?
When you put it that way, it seems so clear.
It's all a setup. He's going to be fine. They're going to dye his hair, give him eye color, set him up with some Ukrainian bride somewhere in an island in the Caribbean, and that'll be that.
They'll say he's assassinated,
they'll shut down the WikiLeaks, declare victory, and move on.
So, to back out, we're recording this just after we finished another after show, and we had to end the show to say, look, we're privately going to record this so you can enjoy this later. And we're talking to you guys. You were there, right?
I'm just joking.
Everybody back in the chat room is all pretending that they're watching this feed right now. So they're all saying, I'm so glad I bought that Diamond membership. No, your audio is fine, Brian, but the video is frozen. And then meanwhile, everyone's pretending to watch us record this to each other. It's so, look at this.
Yeah, I still hear Rooker.
There's nobody, they're not watching anything right now, but they're all pretending like they're watching the show to impress each
other. Boo this man.
Boo you, Brian. Martin Sargent's here.
Apparently Martin Sargent's here.
Yeah, well, obviously they're not watching, because that would never happen, because Justin would never allow that man on your show.
No. You know what? Listen, I'm sick of him strutting around like, oh, I had a podcast a couple years ago. Now take, for example, Santa Claus we had on last week.
He was a guy
who showed up and killed maybe the funniest guest we've ever had on NSFW. If Martin Sargent were a little bit more like old Santa Claus, maybe we'd have him on. Otherwise,
people are being fooled, too. This guy's saying, "Where's the live link?"
I'm serious, Justin. I think what you're saying is right. If we all had a little more Santa in us, the world would be a better place. And no one needs more Santa in him more than Martin Sargent.
Exactly. I want Santa really just needs the full bore. Get himself right up in Martin Sargent first.
Crawl up right in his backside.
All right.
Yeah. Listen. Coming down his chimney one way or another.
Since this is an auspicious occasion, we are about to toss to our big story here. What was the most meaningful thing? What will you remember about 2010? Like, what is going to stick with you forever? And I know one of the moments for me is going to be on stage at the Dignation live event at Stubbs, South by Southwest, essentially doing an impromptu first live NSFW show ever, because they gave us the project of come up with a world record, and we came up with the OMG Conan hoax, and all of a sudden I find me and Justin on stage addressing the world on a hoax that I am told eventually reached Conan himself.
It was me, you, and Amtrekker.
Brett Ramtrekker, yeah.
We came up with that, and it became a URDB thing. We wound up getting coverage from the Wall Street Journal and CNET. But it was, the most beautiful thing about this kind of technology and like stuff like Twitter kind of exploding is that there's all these sort of like soft spots and ways that we can kind of exploit things. And that was just such a great example of like, hey, listen, there's a bunch of, how many people were there? What was the capacity at Stubbs?
I believe the capacity is 4,000. I think we were briefly over capacity. I know they turned people away.
Yeah, so we had 4,000 Twitter savvy people with cell phones that we could completely take advantage of, and we did it. It was a trending topic on Twitter, and we wound up getting Conan O'Brien called, and I guess it was probably late afternoon California time. But
so
that
for me was one of the highlights. Did you have one that was a definite standout in 2010?
I would have to say Dragon Con, just the entire Dragon Con experience. I mean, I had never been to a Dragon Con before, and it was really kind of the one of the milestones for NSFW as a show to understand that like okay, where there's all these other fantastic shows over there, a lot of skeptic podcasts, a lot of sci-fi stuff, and obviously even up to like shows, like actual panels with actors who were on television and stuff like that. And and Tom, you and Veronica with Sword and Laser. And it was just really kind of cool to see where is NSFW on this chart and have everybody be so excited and have, you know, what was it? Scott Sigler, right? The author.
Oh, yes, yes, yeah.
Who had the task of being in the room right next to us.
I didn't know
I was on that panel.
Oh, you were, on the panel?
Yeah, in the room next to you during your show.
And so what was going on? And first of all, I didn't know that there was anyone next door, and I didn't know that we were ruining anyone else's party right next to us as we were doing
it. So I'm on this panel. It's the first thing I have to do is I have to go in and I have to ask the moderator, hey, you know, the guys next door asked me to come into their panel at the very end. You know, do you mind if okay if I leave just a little bit early?
Yeah.
And he's like, yeah, that's okay. No, yeah, no problem. He was understanding about it.
To set up something for people who don't know about Dragon Con, everything is scheduled very tightly. Like, everything needs to get on at the right time, get off at the right time, because everything is back to back to back to back to back to back to back. It's not like, Tom, you could say, like, well, you know, this might go long or short, let me just take off, or you could come in on our show if we just ran a little long. You had to take time out of that panel to come on to our panel.
Yeah, I had to leave 10 minutes early of the panel, and I'm trying to find the name of the panel. Was it Saturday night?
Yes, it was Saturday night, because I drove in Friday night, I believe. Or maybe it was Friday night, actually.
No, I think it was Friday night. We did Saturday night, Brian did his magic show.
Yeah, yeah,
it was Mike Stackpole was the moderator. And then I was on with Gary Kim Hayes, Gail Z. Martin, and Scott Sigler talking about fiction writing and skepticism. So this is, you know, this is not a boisterous topic. This is a very serious topic. People talking about their fiction and how it informs skepticism and fantasy and religion and all this stuff. And there was a decent crowd. It wasn't a huge crowd. It was an evening skeptic thing. So there's maybe, I don't know, 50 people in a room that would normally seat 100, 150. And we're talking, and we'll say, you know, somebody like Mike Stackpole or Scott Sigler would say something
who are
like
big names. I mean, anyone who doesn't recognize these names in the sci-fi community, they're huge.
These are best-selling authors. Yeah,
I read Mike Stackpole back, you know, a decade ago. Man, I've been a huge fan.
So they're saying things like, well, you know, one of the things when I deal with religion in my books is that I try to make sure that I have a fair hand while I don't fall, you know, subject to extemporizing on mythology. Roars of laughter coming through the wall behind us.
I mean, I like to think that it was, you know, added like Scott Singer, a much like, needed well, laugh track to that panel. Where you no, like the points were made.
So Justin's assertion
like
is that
good
is
time
that
we, over there.
So Justin's assertion is that we made it better by adding a laugh track to this pontificating.
Well, it could have been better timed for us. Well, probably timed perfectly for
we,
you.
We took your panel and we made it better.
And then I left the panel and went next door and walked in with an American flag draped around me.
That was awesome. That was awesome. That touch of the American flag, which was, I believe, was Justin's idea, right?
Yeah. Oh. Well, I was obsessed with doing a wrestler ending. I wanted to do a wrestler run-in for our first live show, and Tom was nice enough to do it.
So amazing.
And so,
by the way, there we go.
So I hope Mike Stackpole realizes why he allowed me to leave his panel early.
Oh, I hope he doesn't realize.
Actually, you know, you're right. I hope he doesn't have any.
I'm already noticing a theme here, because our best moments, Tom was there, South by Southwest. Tom was there at Dragon Con. Tom, what was your one of your best moments of 2010?
You guys weren't there, but it was me moving towards you.
Okay, go
my
on.
My best moment of 2010 is when I emailed Leo Laporte in January and said, hey, does that offer to hire me still stand?
No kidding. So you reached out to him.
Well, he had talked to me about coming to work at Twit before. And at the time, at those times, I had said, nah, you know, it's not the right time for me, whatever. And then he had said, well, if you ever need a job, you just email me. And so I emailed him, and he's like, well, let's talk. And what happened that first conversation, I went down, we had dinner, and I said, I don't want to leave CNET. I just want to go freelance. I want to be able free to do different kinds of content in different places. So what I'm talking to them about is going part-time. And he's like, well, come do a show on Twit. And that's how Current Geek Weekly started.
So in your mind, it was just like your goal was to keep doing the things you like doing at CNET, but also add some other new projects that you would like at Twit. Because because
I was doing all these independent podcasts anyway.
Yeah.
So I was like, I want to turn those into money makers, but I can't do that and be full time at CNET because of their policies there. So I was trying to find a way around that. Ended up not working out. CNET didn't want me to stay on and do anything there. That's fine. No bad blood at all. I understand their position. The way it works in corporate America, if you are paying somebody something, then why pay other people more things? And they decided in the end, you know what? We'd actually rather have a full-time employee than a part-time employee. So it just didn't work out that way.
So, but like at the time that you were thinking about going part-time, Tech News Today would not have been part of that until CNET said, we don't want you to be doing...
At the very beginning, at the very beginning, that was the idea. At the very end, I had decided I was going to be doing Tech News Today for Twit. There were even conversations about whether they would take Tech News Today and air it, you know, and Molly would be on Tech News Today. This is before it was called Tech News Today.
Yeah.
Really, really early conversations about, you know, what are the possibilities. So there was never negativity about any of it. And so the whole process was really positive all the way through. And it just ended up being me doing what I felt was best for me. And I'm so glad I did it. I'm having such a blast doing the show at Twit, having the freedom to do other shows and focus on them and concentrate on them. Doing the top five over at Revision 3 is fun too. So the most memorable moment for me is probably that.
That reaching
first
out moment, like that
step,
that's
of saying,
the
you know what, I
want to
do
moment.
Something. I don't want to just sit here and be stuck with what I'm doing.
Yeah,
awesome. It seems like this year in general with podcasting, it was kind of all about the network and the evolution of, you know, taking a brand and kind of exploding it from you know, Adam Carolla taking a podcast, making a network, Kevin Smith taking a podcast, making a network, and you know, the next step for Leo's Twit Network is, you know, to bring a workhorse in like you to do, you know, a show like Tech News Today, a day or a 5 days a week version of Twit, and, you know, so much more, up to and including stuff like NSFW, where, you know, this is far, well, not far beyond, because they were doing This Week in Fun before it, but certainly beyond what they had normally done content wise to have just like a straight up and down comedy show.
My second best memory is being turned into a spider.
Yes, the Merit Spider.
Merit Spider. Man, you know what's funny is like people will remind me of things we've done on NSFW show. I'm like, that's ridiculous. That must have taken like days of work. And I'm like, no, we dreamed that up at 3 o'clock the day of the show.
Dude, here's how bad
I remember that day
is.
When you're like, okay, we have this idea. It wasn't even a spider at the time. It was like you were going to have me on with lips moving and my mouth or whatever.
Yes.
And the idea changed like 3 times and then finally gave me some lines to record. And it was great. I loved it.
It was
awesome.
Dude, here's how bad my memory is about remembering what we've done is that I was looking through just like, you know, when you're in your Gmail and you see to the left all of your contacts to see like who's on like GTalk. And somebody was on and they had this weird quote. And so I scroll over it just to see what the end of the weird quote was. It was something about like, and here, the unicorns for which I've provided your family. And then at the end, it was like, Justin Robert Young. Like I said. And I'm like, I have no idea what that was about, where I said it, or why it's funny. But this guy loved it.
You know, I had that same experience watching it. We edited together the best of TNT for the year. I'm watching it, and there's things where I'm like, I do not remember that happening.
That's
like,
awesome.
And I would say stuff. I'm like, I don't remember ever saying that. If somebody had come up to me on the street and said, you know, you said blah, 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 blah to Sarah Lane, I would have been like, no, I never said that. What are you talking about?
And then there it is in your face.
I know.
Hey, I want to do something kind of meta here that we've never done on the show before, because we're running out of our free space playtime, and we're going to go to our awesome encounter with Michael Rooker. But first, I want to talk about something that I never expected to happen in 2010, was to pull on a passionately supportive sponsor by doing the counterintuitive and being as ridiculous as possible to the point of horrifying Sarah Lane. And let me just say, first of all, the people at Squarespace are amazing because they clearly get the humor of NSFW. They get that we have a passionate fan base. And if you don't know, you're an idiot. You are fundamentally flawed as a human being, and you need to die in a fire if you don't know that Squarespace provides the best looking websites on the internet. They are instantly selectable. You don't have to have a bunch of CSS wizardry or know your HTMLs or be a Photoshop wizard or any of that crap. You can look professional and awesome with a free no risk trial. You go sign up. They don't even ask for a credit card. You can have one registered by the time I finish the sentence that I'm speaking after this one. So I've got to make this a very long sentence.
And lo, a pale horse appeared.
But the point is the websites look amazing. They stand up to huge amounts of traffic because of their distributed network servers. And they're not going to go down. You're going to look like a champ. And if you are a wizard, it's super, super customizable. So you look awesome. Do us a Hell favor. Yeah. Make us some kind of creative...
If you're a wizard, you won't even have to use any of your sympathy or dark arts.
No. Exactly. You will expend no mana on a Squarespace page. No. We will promise you
your MP to yourself there, Buster Brown, because Squarespace has got all the wizardry you need.
That's right. And if you're looking for something to do, if you want to try it out right now, sign up for the free two-week trial. You don't even have to give them a credit card, and make your favorite moment of 2010 page. If it's an NSFW memory, that's great. If not, something else, share it with us. Go ahead
or
and send
fake.
It to us.
Make up fake memories and just
make
pass it around
memories.
To all your friends.
Remember the day you stabbed Scrooge McDuck in the eyeball with a pencil?
Remember that time I grabbed Natalie Portman's side boob?
Oh, do you remember the time that me and Michael Rooker found a hobo and we beat OMG Chad with a hobo? Nobody's been beaten with a hobo. People beat hobos.
I did not like that day.
That's
that was not a great day.
But
this, for me.
But the amazing thing was, it turned out it was his dad.
I know.
Oh my gosh.
That was very embarrassing for me.
I was
to be
crying.
Like, Dad, no.
Everybody was laughing at the end, like, what?
How did that happen?
I can't believe that happened.
What memories do you want to remember on NSFW?
Oh, I try to wipe that all out.
Oh, come on. You need a lasting memorial. All right.
No. I would post about the time that I died in a fire.
Yeah, as specifically instructed over and over and over and over again.
Right.
I'm going to feel bad the first time somebody has a house fire. I'm going to regret that slogan.
Okay, here you go. Here's your out. Here's your save for that slogan. You're merely quoting Jean-Luc Picard.
Does he say die in a fire?
His nephew, he died in a fire.
Oh,
really?
No,
that's terrible. Wow. We got to find that clip.
I think it's from the movie.
Generations. Yeah, that's what he said. That's when he breaks down and cries.
That's amazing.
All right, look, make sure to use promo code NSFW. Not only does it get you 10% off the lifetime of your order, which is going to be a lot of money over a long time, but it also keeps us in business. But while we're talking about our friends over at Squarespace, Justin, when was the moment you realized that maybe there was a love connection between Squarespace and NSFW?
For those new listeners, about halfway through this year, we kind of decided that we weren't going to read reads the way that everybody else read reads.
I mean, unless that was their instructions.
Correct.
We were going to, I mean, if anyone, I mean, look, we're loyal denizens.
The fast and easy way to publish a high quality website or blog. For 10% off the lifetime of your account, go to squarespace.com and use the offer code NSFW. Squarespace. Fast and easy web publishing.
That's the problem, is that we knew everybody had heard that ad.
Yeah.
Squarespace was a unique situation.
Like, I know for my listening habits, you know, I listen to a lot of Twit programming, listen to a lot of Revision 3 programming, and a lot of these networks share advertisers, you know, and that's because they reach a demographic that I am clearly a part of. So our goal was to make reads that you've heard a billion times before, even on this show, sound different, and the only way that we knew how to do that was just to completely make them really dumb And it was kind of a gamble because it's not like we cleared them with anybody or asked them.
Well, although it does say, you know, share your personal experience, tell your own stories, make this your own is the instruction.
We certainly made it our own. And I think that it was during one of them, and I can't even remember which read it was, but I remember one of them, I felt that I had gone over the line. I actually wound up even apologizing
that was the same
by
night,
the end of the show.
That was the same night, like, Squarespace called in, right?
It might have. Oh, I think it was the Jury's Jubilee Empire one. And I had made some joke about how other website hosting services were anti-Semitic. And I kind of had this pang of like, oh my God, I just put anti-Semites and Nazis in the same sentence as somebody who paid money to sponsor this show.
And I wanted to
kind of panic.
Yeah, now you definitely, now you implied it before, but now you've explicitly done it.
Oh, no, I did it then. If you listen back to it, I really went over the line. But what happened, the way that I knew that SiriusXM loved us was because somebody cut out like three reads, and they were all very, very funny, but one of them was the one that I thought I had gone over the line. And Squarespace tweeted it out on their official account and were like, this is the best. We love NSFW. And I'm like,
good.
Oh, thank God. Because now at least it's the person who's running their Twitter that's on the line too. Like, they co-signed on that.
And I think we've dialed it back. But here's what's great about it, and I'm very proud about this, is I think at least in the chat room, people seem to genuinely get excited when it's sponsor read time. And I don't know that happens on a lot of
more
podcasts.
Excited than our actual show.
Yeah.
They're like, thank God this show is over and we can get to the ad reads. Please, let's get to the comedy here, people.
All right. Well, I don't want to bring anyone down, but I do think it's about time that we set up our big bit here. We have a tendency at the show, after the show, we go live with what we call the after show. It's our gift to everybody who hangs out and watches the Sausage Made live, is we go off twit. You know, where the language gets a little more colorful, we're much more interactive with everyone, and we hang out kind of in person. And to our surprise, after we were clearly deciding that show's over and we're out of character, a lot of colorful language, who cares? Maybe a little more of the rocket sauce going on there.
And of course, beer, not the other thing that rocket sauce is surely listed under in Urban Dictionary.
Right, not that.
Well, really, the after show coincided with one of the other really, really big and awesome surprises of 2010 for us, which was the friendship of Michael Rooker, legendary, fearsome character actor Michael Rooker, who came to us by way of Joe Cambiaggio and Andrew Main, who, by the way, if you've enjoyed some of our best episodes of 2010, the real true ghost producer of this show is Andrew Main. So Michael Rooker became a friend of ours, of like an awesome, honest-to-goodness friend, and it actually was before Walking Dead, when he kind of had this really awesome star turn on Walking Dead. He wound up just calling in to the after show. We were horsing around with him on Twitter, and without provocation or asking, our friend Michael Rooker called in, and we had this conversation with him about his career and Walking Dead and all sorts of other awesome stuff, and it was really awesome.
You know what's neat about it is he was always great on NSFW, but in all of our NSFW episodes, there's kind of a white knuckleness to it, where that's not here because it's the after show, because we don't think it counts. We talk sincerely to each other, and I think it's a neat experience. If you actually dig Michael Rooker as an actor, as a performer, as a person, I think you'll dig this unique insight to his personality. So, with all with that, we give you Daddy Rooker.
Ba-boom.
So long, 2010.
Ba-da-ba-ba.
Go die in a fire.
So, and I know every show is different with the development process, but it sounds to me like Walking Dead, what I love about the way you tweet, and I don't know if it's true or not, and I hope it is true, but it sounds like you're watching the show side by side with the rest of us, like as engaged as all of the rest of us, with everything being as surprised as so.
Totally, dude, totally. I've been very well blessed by our creator with a very poor memory. I could have done the show and not remember what we did. So watching it and seeing it for the first time almost.
So what did you think? Okay, there are two big surprises. Now, and obviously, I'm not going to lie. I sort of did a little bit of link bait where I acted like when I retweeted the headline, that's an attention-grabbing headline, you know, fires the staff of Walking Dead or whatever. That's everything right. I've read has clearly...
Sounds like there were a lot of recently disgruntled writers who wanted to talk to Nikki Fink at Deadline.com. Is what, right. That's what that article sounded like to me. Now, far be it from me. I have no inside track. But if I were a bunch of guys who just randomly got fired and I wanted to make a stink out of it, I'd call an industry source that everybody reads and say, holy shit, I can't believe I just got fired. Write about it.
Oh, my God. I only wish that one day I can fire someone.
Anyone at all. I just want to fire people.
I want to fire somebody. I've never been able to fire anyone in my life.
So that was the one thing, and second of all, do you read the comic books? Are you up to date on the comics?
I am not totally. I haven't read them all, so I'm up to, where am I? I got my book here. Where's my book? Oh God, I don't know where it is, but I'm about that far in.
Okay. So you're not in the last 10 or 15 issues. You're deeper back than that.
No, I'm not. I just started reading them when I first started doing the show. And then I stopped reading them because I was involved with the show, and now I'm back reading them again.
Now, when you say you stopped reading them because you were involved with the show, is that because like you wanted to keep your character right for what you wanted it to not have any outside stuff affect your acting on that?
Yeah, pretty much. I don't usually go to the movies or watch television or read stuff. I mean, reading the comics are it's so visual. It's yeah. such a it's so obvious that it should be in a film or a TV series, you know, because it's just that it's written that way. And so there's no way I could actually read them while I was doing the work. Cuz stuff influences you. And sometimes it does it without you even knowing it. So,
well,
I would think also, especially for your character, which was invented just for the television right. series, that you wouldn't want to be looking at all these other characters and be like, oh, well should I be like him or should I be taking elements of that character or that storyline? Just let it breathe by itself, right?
Yes.
No, it's all right. Whatever's on the script, whatever's on the page there, I take in, and then I just use the rest is my imagination, and I don't want a lot of other influences to draw on, especially while I'm doing it or when I'm preparing for it. You know.
Yeah. Now here's all right. Just real quick to go back to that opening scene in episode 3 where you're on the roof. Like, at what point? I mean, is that all in the script that you know Merle starts freaking out and slamming his head on the concrete and you know?
Oh, no,
like, how much of that is you? I mean, like that's what. Yeah, what does it say
that's
in the script versus
me
what do you
bring? That's just me doing. You know, I of course you get your lines down, and I like to work. I like to work in a way that I know my lines so well that I can anything that happens within the scene doesn't have a I won't have a big problem with that and I just allow myself to flow with the scene, you know. It's sort of like a jazz musician, you know. You start out with the note, whatever the song it is, and then you just riff on, and that's kind of what we did in that scene.
So We have a friend of the show who we just finished doing NSFW show with. Her name is Colleen Kelly. If you don't mind, say hi to Colleen right here. She's never seen Mallrats. Can you talk to her and tell her that she needs to see Mallrats?
Hey, Colleen. Hey, hi. How you doing? You ain't seen Mallrats yet.
That's correct.
That's true. Well, there's a very specific scene in there that I gained about 20 pounds for, and I'm coming out. I'm coming.
Is that
out
your
of
excuse?
Shower. I'm coming out of the shower, so I just have to say that if you are into a kind of fat little shiny butts, you're definitely gonna dig mine.
Sweet, Especially when they're doing karate, right? If I remember that scene correctly, yes, you're busting some moves.
That's the scene. That's the scene.
Hey, you have so many movies under your belt. Do you have like pet projects that you're more excited about than others? Like when you look back on your long storied history, what is the role that you're most excited to remember outside of as father to a dog? Oh, okay, so Michael, seriously, like, what is your pet role? You look back, you're like, man, I freaking nailed that.
Wow. I try to do my best work every time, but the ones I really remember are the ones I mess up on.
You know? Really?
Yeah. I always remember the ones I fail on, and the ones that I try to get something and I look at it afterwards and I go, it didn't work, did it?
what would you consider?
If I have friends that are watching, I usually say, okay, if I get it, if I nail it and I land it, you owe me a beer. And if I screwed up, I owe you a beer, okay? And trust me, I've given out a few beers in my time.
I'm so curious, what are the roles that you would consider that you didn't nail all the way?
Let's see. There was that I did earlier on in my career, Henry, Portrait of a Serial Killer. I always thought that should be a musical.
I had heard that you didn't like Henry, Portrait of a Serial Killer, but that's like, you know, one of the definitions of your career. It was such an early tour de force for you. I can't believe you don't think that's awesome.
In my mind,
I'm teasing.
Yeah. Okay. Now that I know Michael, all I'm thinking is like, it's Henry, Portrait of a Serial Killer, and all he's doing is saying, "I ain't got no panties on. I ain't got no panties on. I ain't got no panties on."
Was that some funny shit?
we already got some remixes. We're waiting on one where you could clearly understand the chorus.
The lyrics, of the chorus, the hook.
Yeah.
Oh, it's a club banger. We need people shaking ass to that. We need to hear people to be chanting in the club. The Rooks singing, "I ain't got no panties on the dance floor."
That's what I'm hoping.
I'm
hoping somebody makes like a badass remix where it's like, I understand that this started as a joke, but I really want to dance to Michael Rooker's rendition of "I ain't got no panties on."
That's what I want. Yeah.
That would be crazy, brother. That would be a little nuts. I don't know about that.
So what are you working on? What are you working on now? Like I Hollywood's a funny business in that you never know when suddenly you're going to get that call and they're like, "We really need you right this minute." And then in the meantime, you got to commit to other projects. What are you working on right now?
Well, you know, that is really true. It can be that way. All of a sudden you're working and the next day you're not. And one day you got the lead role in some feature film. Right now, I'm out of work and looking for work. So, hey, if there's anybody out there, come on, let's go.
Rook needs to work tomorrow. Come on.
Listen, the Rook doesn't go to the work. The work comes to Rook, and that's how it rolls.
You got it. Oh, gosh.
I think the
teaser for number three was... I nailed it.
You did.
Dude,
I totally nailed it.
No. Somebody owed you a beer. In fact, Justin and I personally owe you a beer after your opening for number three. Like it was, and you know, as an actor, that it there's this delicate balance. There's the direction, the cinematography, and the acting, and they all have to come together to make a scene like the opening of number three play right and not look silly or over the top. And I mean, goddamn, you nailed it, man. How did it feel when you were done with that?
Exhausted. I was exhausted. We did it for, I think we did the scene maybe three times. But setting it up, getting all the camera angles and over, just all the way through three good, solid times. Every time it just got... It literally got better and better and crazier because, you know, you just get into that scene, and it was tough, man. It was a tough scene, and I was glad when it was over. Let me tell you that.
Well,
yeah, especially in television, you know, where things change. I mean, obviously, we just saw with the fact that, you know, the writer staff can all of a sudden be out of work. You know, things change so rapidly, and characters that come on, leave, characters you thought were gone forever, come back. And what I really thought about, you know, that opening scene is that nobody wants that to be the last time that we see Merle Dixon. You know, we got to see this guy again. And is there any element of that that's running through your mind that, like, you know, that you want to nail it, especially on a TV series where, you know, your resonation with the audience is how you got brought back.
Some part of you is thinking, like, you know, well, this has to resonate. It's like, this is an audition for me to be like, hey, man, I want to see that racist bad guy back. Come on, go.
I got to tell you, that was not even a thought in my mind. I tell you what was going on in my mind. I was very happy and proud to have gotten the opportunity to be able to take this piece of writing that Frank came back from L.A. with. And me thinking that, yeah, I'm in number three. It's my hand, okay, buddy?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm out of here, okay?
Yeah,
same difference,
I've done my
bro.
Thing in number two, and then I'm going home. And then to find out that I have the entire teaser was mind-blowing. And when I started reading it, I just was like going, this doesn't happen. I mean, I've never had the opportunity to tackle this kind of writing, and this the kind of the emotions and the delirium and the praying to my maker and all this stuff rolled into one, and then switching on a dime like that, and then just realizing that you know the guy is at death's at his door and he's gonna die, and everybody would be, I don't know, many people that wouldn't be praying to their God and banging their head on the concrete to try to get some lucid thoughts.
Yeah,
but it was a beautiful piece to sort of get in to envelop you as an artist, and I am like, I bow down to Mr. Darabont every time I think of him. He's an awesome writer, and just the whole idea of getting that scene and putting it as the teaser was just an amazing kicker on what I did in number two, you know. And so
yeah.
I was, man, I don't know what to say. It was just something else.
But you also, for that particular episode, you kind of have to buy the fact that Merle Dixon is up there on that rooftop, and he's that crazed, he's that determined, and he's that maniacal by fear that he does what happens at the end, or else it kind of plays off as cheesy. You know, if you don't know in that. You get that one scene for the audience to buy, this motherfucker will saw his hand off.
Right.
Like, he is not going to take no for an answer. He is going to live no matter what if he can
no
get his hand
No matter what. And, you know, there were a lot of questions about that scene. Why didn't you saw the cuffs? Why didn't you saw the bar, the metal bar? I got to tell you, anybody, I know you can analyze all you want. But when death is at that door, baby, and you don't know if they're coming in the next second or not, let me tell you what, you'll chew your goddamn hand off.
Yes, and that's what I loved, is that clearly Merle Dixon was in a state of, was not in his right mind at that moment. There's any number of nonsensical things he would have done.
Absolutely, absolutely.
And, well, then your brother, the boondocks, get away from there,
yeah.
So I don't know if you know this, but I know a lot of our viewers have tweeted you things. I don't know if you knew that there was a campaign to recruit you for governor. Did you ever see this website, MerleDixonForGovernor.com? Did you check it out?
I haven't seen the website. There's a whole website on it.
Yeah, there's a whole website where there's all kinds of interesting adventures. Apparently, they've upset it. They've updated it recently. There's photos of you as the governor for California. People clearly want you to be the governor. this is easily one of my favorites because you do look like the governor.
Cut a dash.
Am I in the governor's suit and everything with tie and all?
Yes, absolutely. And in fact, there's campaign videos where if you click on this, you can hear you singing "I Ain't Got No Panties On." But my favorite, my favorite is this little gem that just showed up right now. Merle for governor.
Wait, what does he say?
It says Merle for governor. Says kill them all, and it's of course in the style of our president's campaign ads right there. And you notice he's got only one hand. So I'm just saying, Merle for governor, kill them all right there.
Mo Merle, baby. Mo
That's
Merle.
Right.
Mo Merle.
So I noticed, and I made an assumption on my part, but I noticed in your tweets that you refer to Daryl as D-E-R-L-E, and I assumed that was because you had read the script, and that's how his name was spelled. Is that correct? It's Merle and Durrell?
No, the script is spelled Daryl.
Oh.
But I said to Redis, I said, listen, I don't give a shit what the script says. I don't give a crap who wrote this, how they spelt this.
It's Durrell.
No matter how it's spelt, it's pronounced Durrell.
Okay. One item on Merle Dixon for governor that was the greatest thing that ever showed up is taken from an actual text message that showed up on damnyouautocorrect.com. Somebody photoshopped in some photos here. This is, keep in mind, this is an actual text exchange between two people. Only the faces have been changed. It starts off with Michael Rooker saying, your mom and I are going to divorce next month. And Justin says, what? Why? Please call me, please. And it turns out I wrote Disney and this phone changed it. We are going to Disney. Your mom and I are going to Disney next month. So there's that. Let me just put that out there.
Let me ask you, Michael.
He is a good son. I hear he's going to wash my car tomorrow.
I am. No. I'm going to be over. I'll be over bright and early. I'll be like Biff in Back to the Future. I'll make sure I get the two coats of wax.
Oh, my God.
You know, for anybody who hasn't, you know, is not familiar or doesn't know your filmography, you actually worked with this kind of like who's who of super hip, awesome directors. You really have, you know, been someone, you know, James Gunn, Kevin Smith, Oliver Stone. You know, is there, you know, a one that was a particular, you know, favorite in your mind of a director that really kind of stuck out, or a movie that you really, you know, really remember more than the others?
Well, you know what? I've been friends with John McNaughton since Henry. And
oh, really?
He's a great guy. We're still buddies. I still, whenever I go back home to, whenever I go back to Chicago and hang out, and we always hang out and chat. And there's also, you know, some of the very first ones, like in Mississippi Burning, the director of Mississippi Burning, my poor brain. Oh my gosh.
Oh, guys, come on, chat room.
Chat room. Yeah, this was great. We call the chat room our spare brain, because
please,
like
my
we'll
spare
just do
brain.
This, like,
I know. I know.
You know the movie
British
that I'm
guy.
Talking about. What's the one? And then instantly they have it up for
you. Just keep talking. We'll get it here in a
second.
Yeah.
Well. Okay. I mean, and then there was like of course Tony Scott in the Days of Thunder, and Rennie Harlan was a great guy to work with in Cliffhanger. And
people are saying Alan Parker. Was it Alan Parker?
Alan Parker!
Yes!
My God, I
your
couldn't
spare believe brain to the rescue. That's how good they are. Spare brain to the rescue. That's awesome.
Alan Parker was by far one of my favorite directors. He could come up, he could have 150 people on set. And I swear, each one of those people would feel as though they've been spoken to by Alan Parker directly. It was what a wonderful, wonderful man and a great director. And if you remember Mississippi Burning, I was cast as a group. I think I was
really
cast as a group of thugs, Southern KKK thuggish kind of guys, and we had about seven or eight of us. And before you know it, I was like singled out to be the main, you know,
racist number one.
Well, I was number one thug. Yeah.
That's what I wanted to ask. Like, did it bother you, or does it bother you to play roles that are so clearly despicable and so evil? I mean, how do you handle that?
I don't think about it. I just play what's on the page, and then I use my own imagination and let it go, babe. You know,
awesome.
you can't be judgmental with your material. If you are, then you're like constantly questioning yourself. And I don't. I just go and do it and have fun doing it. And sometimes, yeah, the fun is the violence and the ugliness that's going on, because after you do the scene, you and the other actors are hugging and kissing and hanging out and having a beer and going, oh my God, that was such a great scene. You know, so it's not people. It's a movie. It's not real.
Yeah. we went back and forth on Twitter after the second episode with Merle Dixon on The Walking Dead about how much I personally, I really enjoy the fact that Darabont let you play Merle like the way that, you know, a crazed, cocaine-fueled, racist lunatic in the zombie apocalypse would act, and that would, you know, not shy away from certain words, which are, of course, reprehensible.
And that's something
for that character that was real.
That was a moment that the day after that happened, Justin and I, every single time a new Walking Dead comes out, we talk to each other. We're like, "What did you think of X, Y, and Z?" Like, we were so impressed that it wasn't a big deal that you dropped the N-word. Because that's how the character would regard it. Like, yeah, no, I hate you, and I hate you and your kind, and I'm going to say it that way. It was so rare to see that on television nowadays without it being a big deal. Like, you know, no, I'm going to call you the N-word because that's what I think about you.
Well, not only that, he was raised that way. That character obviously was raised in an environment where that description of a person is very well accepted.
Yeah.
And in the South, not necessarily in the South, I'm just saying that when I was a kid, those words were easily thrown about, and it was not a big deal, you know. But I got to tell you, I moved from Alabama when I was 13, and I moved to Chicago, and I experienced more racism in Chicago than I ever had when I was in Chicago and Alabama.
No kidding.
And oh my gosh, yes, yes, yes. It's segregated by, good Lord, bro, it's segregated by blocks. You gotta know which block to walk down and which one not to walk down. You gotta know these things. If you don't know your parameters, you don't know where the one neighborhood ends and the other one begins, you could get your ass stomped big time.
So
you see that in a lot of big cities. I mean, like Boston, New York,
yeah,
Chicago.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's true, and it's so true. So people, a lot of times people like, you know, the South has been dealing with racism and bigotry for a long time. We, in the South, people have learned to accept one another. So, you know, most people, I think, are learning to accept one another as individual people. And not totally looking at you simply by the color of your skin or what kind of what race you are or what nationality you are, and they've been dealing with it for a long time, and so they're much more the people in the South are much more advanced than sometimes folks up in, you know, some of the little neighborhoods in Chicago or Detroit or up in Wisconsin or Ohio. You're going to find racism almost everywhere you go.
Yes.
I don't think
you will. And so you just can't think that. I was asked a question in a little my little hometown newspaper about did it bother you playing a Southerner that is such a racist bigot? And I said, no, it doesn't bother me. It doesn't bother me at all playing these roles, because there are Southerners who are racist and bigots, and there are Northerners who are racist and bigots, and there are people in California. There are so many hate groups. There are more hate groups in California than almost any other state in the union.
Well, no one gives the land between L.A. and San Francisco enough credit for being so up and weird. That's my it's like this weird hidden shame that America has, that everything in between, you know, just north of L.A. and south of San Francisco is the weirdest
the
fucking
desert.
Country in America easily.
Here, brother. I tell you what, Michael Rooker, I treat people as individuals. It doesn't
there we
matter
go.
To me. It doesn't matter to me if you're black or white or red or green or yellow. I don't give a shit, okay? If you're nice to me, if you're cool to me, I'm cool to you. But if you're an asshole to me, I'm going to be, you know, I'm like, you know what? If you hit me, I'm going to hit you back. And I'm
going to
hit
totally.
You harder than you hit me. So,
okay.
And it doesn't matter what, it doesn't matter to me what color of skin this person or this individual is.
And I understand that for you, acting is a project, it's a gig that you do, and of course you care about it, especially in the moment while you're doing it. But once it's over with, I would imagine that you get distracted, you have other things going on. Do you find yourself watching the rest of The Walking Dead, the stuff that you're not involved with, or it's like, or have you, are you too caught up in other stuff?
Dude, I gotta tell you, I am such a geek fan. I love this show.
Yes!
I love this show. We have friends over every Sunday, and we're all eating chips and dip and drinking beers and watching The Walking Dead.
So now you were credited in the last episode as a guest star, right? There was confusion that your name popped up in the credits. What the f*** is up with that?
Wait,
I have no idea. I'm certainly not getting paid for it.
You gotta call up Frankie D and be like, "Listen, it's
hey, Frankie,
I don't know,
you put
an Amazon gift card.
Where's my paycheck,
like,
Frank?
Hey, what's going on?"
Yes. So what did you think of? What did you think of the dramatic turn? Because you've read the comics, and I don't think it's a surprise to you. The way they ended Sunday's episode is not in the comics at all. I don't know if you knew that or not, but it's very different. How did you read that?
You know what? I read it by I'm going by Kirkman's own words. He's saying it's different. It's going to be different.
Yes.
And I think most of the comic fans have already realized that it's going to be different. And I think they're digging it because of that. Because I got to tell you, I wouldn't want to read these comics. These comics are amazing. You know, and they you cannot put them down.
Yes.
Every at the end of every page, it's another page turner. You gotta continue.
Absolutely.
And is that true or what with you guys?
I mean, oh my God!
Oh no, absolutely.
I'm not gonna lie. Like last night, and this is gonna sound like I'm making up an argument that Justin and I had, but less than 20 hours ago, Justin and I were arguing. He was like, "Well, I got this problem with the story," and I'm like, "We just need to read a few more episodes." He's just like, "You know what? You could tell me what happens during those episodes because I'm getting frustrated at this point."
It's, no, you can't tell them. You got to read it yourself, bro.
That's what I'm saying.
No, no, and I read. And please, no, stop it. You're only telling half the story. Because then I said, all right, I'm gonna read everything up until, you know, the last volume that just came out on
the
Tuesday,
last
which I did. But
well,
you know
what
it is.
I can't read novels. They're just so long, and I kind of you know sort of you sort of figure it out, and you figure it out along the way, and you're like, okay, I know what's gonna happen, and so. But these things, I love short stories, and these things are so short. And they're just wonderful, and I can't stop reading them. I love them dearly, and we are all fans here. My whole family, everybody here in this house, we're all fans, and our friends are coming over and watching every Sunday, and it's been kind of a lot of fun. It's been a way of communicating and enjoying one another and enjoying your friends.
It's almost as though earlier this evening I made the joke like. You get so much of the story out of previews for movies. How come somebody doesn't make a whole movie, 90 minutes of nothing but preview-style cuts, where it's just moving the story forward? And that's kind of what you get out of a comic book, right?
It's gorgeous, and it's written in a visual way, too. I mean, you got all those panels, and it's just gorgeous. I've been really digging them, and I mean, to really answer your question again, I love the series, and I'm watching it. And yeah, there are some things I don't. When I see something, as I'm looking at it, going, no, I disagree with that.
Yes,
I would. There's no yes. way in hell you're going to go in that garage with those guys, and there's no way you're going to let your hostage go in there first, and then you're going to follow them in. without your guy coming out? Forget it, bro. That's no way. No way you do that.
It's one of those things where the strength of The Walking Dead is that it's number one, agonizing choices, and it's about people over zombies. Zombies are just the vehicle of the apocalypse. This could just as easily be about a disease that sweeps the world. It could just as easily be robots that destroy the world. It doesn't matter.
It is about a disease that sweeps the world.
Well, apparently, from the last episode.
Very literally.
Yeah, correct.
But guys, I am totally into it. I'm dying to figure out. I can't wait to figure out what they're going to come up with and what's going to be in the second season. And I'm as anxious as everyone else.
Well, number one, I hope it's more Merle. Number one, that's first.
You gotta do it right though. Okay, you gotta do it right, man. It's gotta be.
Oh, of course.
Oh,
right. Okay, so
I'm sorry, Mo Merle. I know. Just real quick, you're talking about the comics. I think. For Kirkman, and I don't know how much time you spend with him or talk to them, Michael, but it would be a very interesting thing because, I mean, he's done Walking Dead now for how many years to be able to go back and say, all right, there were always these things, and looking back in hindsight, I could have done differently or I should have done differently with these opening stories. And maybe I want to add these new ideas and kind of take these characters in a bit of a different direction, and to have not only that kind of opportunity, but also one where, I mean, Jesus, this show is violent and dark and gory and you know, it's so you know, depressing and bleak. It's almost beautiful, like the scene you know, last week with you know, Amy you know, going through her change or whatever.
Oh my gosh,
it's like, I can't imagine another show that's played with this kind of despair in such a crazy way.
And you know what? It is beautiful, and it's deadly and it's beautiful, and it's ugly and it's beautiful because it's life, man. And you know, she could have just as easily be dying of cancer, you know.
Yes.
It's like, you know, you're looking at two people saying goodbye to one another, and that's what was going on there. You know, I think I read, and a couple people were like, oh, I can't wait to see a kind of someone go through the throes of the fever that gets you, right? And lo and behold, the next show deals exactly with that. And I think, you know, when you're working with someone, a director or another actor, and then all of a sudden you start reading each other's minds, and all of a sudden the scene is just cooking and moving and going great. That's what we're doing here. I think The Walking Dead is a character here, and the public is another character in this big play we're doing, and we're kind of ebb and flow, and we're reading each other's minds, and it's really, really cool.
So I do want to let you know, Rook, my mom did watch the pilot episode.
Oh, she did? I'm kidding. You didn't even tell me this. You didn't tell me that your mom actually watched it.
She watched the pilot, and she said that the reason why she doesn't normally watch shows like that is because the imagery, specifically the image of the half zombie crawling through the lawn, got stuck in her head, and she couldn't stop thinking about it until she was disturbed by it. But I said, listen, just whatever you do, just watch at least the beginning of episode 2 so you can see who was waking you up at 10:30 at night. So she's gonna watch
tell her she's got to watch number 2 and the beginning of number 3 at least.
Yes. No, absolutely.
That way she'll understand the man that loves her dearly, and I'm so happy that we have such a child of
That was the thing. That was the thing that we took a gamble in suggesting that to be our bit. We just assumed you were the type of person who could call a random stranger and beg them to watch your show and do it with class and be a badass about it. And holy shit, did you nail it? That was easily one of our favorite moments in the history of the show. You get out there and call random people.
Your mom is awesome. I don't know if you did. You cue her in that I was going to call her at all?
All I told her was that we wanted to use her on a bit on the show. I didn't tell her what it was about. I didn't tell her who was calling. I didn't tell her to watch anything beforehand or not watch anything beforehand. I just said there's going to be a weird phone number because when you call off the internet, it's just all gobbledygook on the phone. I said just it's going to be me. Pick up the phone, and you're going to be on the show. And she's like, oh, well, I'm going to be sleeping. And I'm like, no, it's even funnier. It's funnier if you're sleeping because then you'll be really confused.
Oh, yes. And I love her ending. Well, she should be an actress. She was so great.
No,
if in fact I say yes, that means I can hang up and go to sleep. Yes, please, yes.
No, she was so excited. The next day she calls me up and she's like, "So what the fuck was going on there?"
She was so funny. She was really great, and I got to tell you, I like doing that. That was a lot of fun. I did a scene one time in a movie in New York City where they couldn't figure out how to, and they said, "Oh my God, there's so many people. We'd have to get so many releases. We have to sign so many releases." I said, "Why do you want to do that? Just give me the flyers, put the van across the street, open the side door, put the camera on the side of the seat there, and get a long lens and turn it on. And I'll start around the corner, around the block, and I'll just go around talking to people and asking them and handing out my flyers." And that's what we did. And we got the scene in one take, and it was beautiful. We had real people talking to me about a missing person. That's what we were doing. And I swear they were like it was the best scene in the movie.
So I got a question for you. And as somebody who has been working in Hollywood for what, 30 years now, is that right? Since early 80s?
Yeah, I came out here from Chicago probably right before I got cast in Days of Thunder.
Okay, so I had lunch with Teller a while ago, and I asked him about what it was like to get recognized, Teller of Penn & Teller. And he said at the time, this is in the early 90s, he said, "I get recognized just enough for it to be cute." And like, he clearly, like, not enough to where it was annoying, but enough where he liked it. Like, how do you deal with that? Like, do you get recognized too much, or when do you like it, when don't you like it?
You know what? I always like it. I don't have a problem with it. I think it's kind of fun when people recognize me and we chat a little bit, and it's like brand new, and I don't know them, they don't know me, and we just have this conversation that is kind of out of the blue, and it works really well.
See,
and I'm not that kind of person that's like, "Oh, go away, get away from me," or I don't hide from people, and I think it's kind of cool. And you know what? It's sort of like I can almost see myself in everyone, because if I'm looking at someone that is like my favorite movie star or my favorite character in a movie, and I know that this moment is never going to come again ever in my lifetime, my goodness, I'm going to go up. You know, I hope I have the strength one day to say, "Can I just shake your hand, or can I say hi and say that I love your work?"
I think I've
done that once before, and other people do the same to me, and I find it really very, very rewarding for both them and I.
What I heard was that nobody hates somebody walking up, taking 5 seconds to say, "I really enjoy your work," shake their hand, and then leave. Like, if you keep it brief like that, no matter who the celebrity is, you know, nobody begrudges that. Is that true?
That's right. No, almost nobody. I mean, there are some people that have come to the end of their ropes. I don't know how their day's going, you know? Yeah, because you've heard of horror stories that happen, and I've never been in the position where anyone has ever, for me, felt like they were bothering me.
Yes.
You know, yes. I have never felt that yet. And I hope I never do. I mean, but, you know.
It means you're old when you do. That means they hate you. That means you don't deserve to father this kid.
Well, you know, God, people do, I mean, stare. Jesus. Who would want to? I do want to know, what do you get recognized for the most? Is there one that's you know, head and shoulders above it? Because I have a guess, but I want to know what it is.
It's regional. If I'm
really?
In the Southeast, if I'm in the South anywhere, or if I'm in Texas or anywhere out in the Midwest, or not the Midwest, but the central states, and it's Days of Thunder by far.
Really?
I am like Rowdy Burns, no matter what role I ever do ever again, I'm still Rowdy Burns to these folks. And Rowdy Burns is, I mean, he is the man. I got to tell you, and Days of Thunder was an awesome, awesome project. And when I am down there in Louisiana and places like that where we do a lot of work down in that area because of, you know, I've done a few things down there, and 13-year-old kids come up and they're like, "Are you Rowdy Burns?" And I'm like, "My God, this is just amazing." And
that's awesome.
It tickles me, and it makes my heart feel full. And I just say, wow. Well, I played Rowdy Bird, but my name's Mike Rooker.
So you tell the kid, hell no, and you sidearm him in the face is what you do. Hey,
that's funny.
All right, so wait, hold on. I need to know the other region. So the South, you have Days of Thunder. Where else do people recognize you? Or what movie?
Well, in Chicago, I get a lot of Henry, and I get a lot of my detective stuff, like Replacement Killers. And and stuff like that, and Sea of Love, and the Bone Collector, New York, and places, the big cities. I get a lot of that, a lot of those movies where I've played tough detectives and FBI guys and stuff like that. And I can't really say. I got to tell you, the one that really comes out is Henry. There are multiple generational fan. The fan base is 3-4 generations. Days of Thunder is 2-3 generations as well. I mean, some of those older movies are just so memorable that they're still being seen and they're still current, you know?
I mean, the kids got to recognize you from Mallrats, though. Because Kevin Smith
yes,
is such
Mallrats
a dedicated
very
audience.
Mallrats is a very big one, yeah.
So, the chat room just asked what I think is a very good question. Obviously, there's a lot of people who want to follow in your footsteps. What was your first role? How do you get started? I mean, obviously, you are the king, pimp, Mac Daddy, king of everything. How, before you got there, like, what's the first step to get to that point? Where did you start?
Well, I educated myself. You know, I went to a theater school and I had to learn, you know, I didn't know diddly squat about acting. And so I just had this this ability to kind of understand the material, the literature. I've always been very good at understanding what's going on between the lines.
So,
and to me, I think that's more important than the actual lines. What I mean, literally, when you look at that, for example, when you look at the scene we were talking about earlier in the beginning of The Walking Dead number 3, that whole teaser, when you're hearing the lines, but when you can see what's going on in between those lines, what's behind those lines, and why the person's saying those lines, that's more important to me than any amount of great writing. And all great writing lends itself for that. So you don't have to do a lot. You read it and all of a sudden you're feeling it and expressing it, and it just goes that way. So so what I'm saying is I didn't know technique. I didn't know anything about acting. And so I went and I auditioned for a school there. It's a conservatory type school out of Chicago. It was called the Goodman School of Drama at the time. And now it's at DePaul University. It's called the Theater School at DePaul, and it's the school's maybe about 80 years old. I don't know the number yet, but it's all kind of Stanislavski method, Stanislavski stuff, and it was very heavily in that kind of acting program. You know, you got to be asked back every year, so that was a challenge for me, you know. And some kid coming out of the neighborhood, I didn't know much about acting, so that's what I did. I got my feet wet by going to school, and then after school I just did theater, man. I would say to anyone, go do theater.
Well, and because you did theater, from what little crossover I've had with movie, TV, you know, shooting dramatic type stuff, it's so different because on theater, all you're doing is shouting with different inflections so that you could physically be heard in the auditorium, right? But it's like
that's
the,
not right. No. Right
at all. What I mean by that.
Oh, sorry, no, Brian. Why don't you educate Michael Rooker?
No. What I mean by that is.
No, please, Rooker, quiet, please.
All right.
Okay, hold
Justin,
on. Right.
Screw you. Screw you. What I'm saying is...
I understand what you're saying. You do. There are techniques. There are specific techniques that you have to learn in the old days to do a good theater piece. Because you literally, you do have to be heard at the back row.
Yes.
And you also have to keep it honest and real as well. So, but nowadays, I don't care what theater you're in, it could be the best acoustically built theater in the world. They're still putting mics on these actors.
Yes.
And so you don't have to do any of that. You don't have to really learn how to perform on a major stage anymore because everything's mic'd.
But specifically what I was saying is that the camera picks up such subtle moments that can't happen in traditional theater, like the moment of a swallow and you see the muscles clenching, that will not translate in a giant theater at the Globe, you know, or whatever. And it's like, and
Jesus, how long do you think he's been acting?
Since the days of Shakespeare, sir. But the point is what I'm saying is was there a shift for you to transition to the style of acting that is relevant in film and in television that is not what necessarily works in theater?
Well, my theater experiences in Chicago were from a very small non-equity theaters into a little larger equity theaters, and every one of them were probably under 300 seats. And so the acting in those small theater in that venue was not real different from being on the set in front of a camera.
So you could afford to be 100% mentally in the moment and not think about projecting, like, well, how do I act agonized? It's like, for you, it was at that moment, it's like, well, I want to feel agonized.
Well,
and
well,
transit.
you don't, that's a misconception. You don't, in my opinion, that is a big mistake, because if you start thinking that, then you're not really there in the moment at all. You know, you're doing nothing but technique, and you can fool a lot of people a lot of the times, but you're not going to ever fool yourself.
Right.
So you know when you're there and when you're not there. And so, yeah. And then we've all had those moments when we know we're not in the scene. And sometimes, you know, the techniques are getting in the way. The camera is right up your nostril, or you have to speak louder than you normally would to be heard in a theater piece. But you still have to somehow, and the good ones do this. You gotta find some way to still make it believable for yourself. And I've always said, if it's believable for me, if I believe it, then you're gonna believe it. And no matter what medium I'm working in, theater or a TV or a film or whatever.
Yes.
People are asking a lot in the chat room what the deal with Pennhurst is, when they're going to be able to see a trailer.
Oh my God, Pennhurst. Well, you know what? I did this film where I was going to play this role, and I ended up playing the role. But my producer friends asked me if I would direct it, and I foolishly said yes. I kind of wish I had never said yes. I gotta be perfectly honest with you.
Why is that?
Because I, you know what? It's just hard work. It's hard work. I don't like to work too hard. Okay.
We can certainly relate with that sentiment. We're right there on board with you.
Are you with me, man?
Yeah, 100%.
Hell yeah,
you
bro,
got it, dude.
You
know?
But it's hard, and you're there, and you know, as an actor, you get to do your stuff, and you get to bow out and go to your trailer and hang out a little bit. But in directing, you got to be there 24/7, and it's sometimes that's hard to do.
So does that mean that what happened with Pennhurst?
So Penn, okay, you really want to know. Okay, well,
listen, Michael Rooker, when you randomly call into an internet show, you have to expect that the hard-hitting questions are going to be here.
Yeah. Do I know how to? Am I a politician or what?
Yeah.
Do I answer the question? I answer not only the question with a question, but I go off on a tangent. See? Well, I don't have exact dates or anything for you. We're in post-production. And I'm just starting to work with my editors now, and or editor, I should say, and I hope we're going to. Oh well, my goodness, I hope we're going to be done with it within the year, you know.
Cool.
It's, you know what? It's a cool little piece. It's got potential. I always thought it had potential, and I think with some real good post-production magic, we may come out okay.
No, come on. I'm sure it's good. And this is the first time that you've directed something, right?
Yes, it's the first time I've directed something, and I will give you a Michael Rooker statement that I will never ever give any director that I work with a hard time ever again.
You learned a lesson.
James Gunn said to me, he said, Rooker, you know what, buddy? I think this is going to be good for you. And guess what? He was so, so, so right. I mean, dealing with the cook, so many cooks in the kitchen on projects, no matter what the budget is, no matter what, you're always going to have people that know how to do it better than you, people who have their people who are in power that have suggestions that you have to actually listen to without saying, go screw yourself, get off the set. Yeah. And then there are people that just come up and just, you know, caterers and say, you know what, it'd be cool if this were to happen and this were to happen. And so, there are a lot of cooks in the kitchen, and sometimes you have to go, guys, can you get off the set, please?
Yeah, you know, GTFO.
I mean, the thing that you have going for you that, you know, Oliver Stone and Kevin Smith and James Gunn don't, are that you can just channel Rowdy Burns and tell him to get the off the set. You know, they don't have that gear.
It's
you
very
do.
True, and I think that's what happens when people come up to me on the street and they actually feel that they've overstayed their welcome. Let me tell you, they turn around and go away. So.
Oh yeah. No,
I don't have a big problem with people getting into my space and staying there when they're not wanted, you know.
I've got a question for you, Michael. That I'm not gonna lie, this is totally personal. This is me as a greedy individual wanting to hear some wisdom from the mount. When you do acting, I assume it's like you're Tarzan swinging from vine to vine. You're going from gig to gig, and you just assume the next vine is going to be there for you. As my day job being a magician, I never know really what's going to happen. I love doing all the online stuff that we do, but I never know what the next gig is going to be. At what point do you just give up and just assume there's always going to be another vine? Or how did you deal with that issue? Because for me, it's terrifying, especially now that I have kids.
I'm still dealing with it. and you just got to know that. Oh, wow. I grew up, I got to tell you, I grew up in the South. We had no money. I mean, literally, I grew up on welfare, 80s, I mean, with food stamps and all this stuff. And money has never been my main focus or goal. And so it's one of those things that if you're doing something you really love to do, it's going to happen, and you're just, you know, it's going to happen. So I try not to get down on myself, and I try not to get too, like, pushy or you know, sometimes you can get hungry, and you're too hungry. So you got to just know that
too wound up.
You are, and just, it's going to come. It's going to be there. And because that's my whole life. I mean, that's my whole life in the arts as an actor, as an artist. you really don't. I think there's only been one time in my entire career where I had three things lined up.
Yes.
Really?
Yeah, there's only one time in my entire career that I knew I had three gigs back to back. And there's only been one time in my entire career that I've been out of work for more than 6 months.
And that's for me as a traveling performer, as a minstrel, essentially, yeah. It's always you view your stability in terms of how far you're booked out. Like, well, I know the next 6 months, come hell or high water, unless I break a leg, I'm going to do these gigs. And I guess it's the same thing for a working actor?
It's totally the same thing. But I think sometimes, you know, I don't know a lot of actors that that are in the position where they know exactly what they're going to do 6 months from 7 months, 8 months from now, unless you're in a long running theater piece.
Right.
Or if you're in a TV show. But as we touched on earlier, TV is very volatile. The ratings, if your ratings go down, you're out of there next season. So you know what, if you're in a good thing, and if you got a good role and the piece is good, you can't start thinking, because you brought up the question, did you think about when doing that the teaser in at the beginning of number three in Walking Dead, did you think about this as an audition? I didn't at all. I didn't even think of that. I to be honest, I did this Walking Dead as, I mean, those episodes I'm in are a la carte, baby. Yeah. I just did them a la carte. I did, okay, I'm in one, I'm in two, okay, cool. I mean, cool. I do them as okay, that's what I got. And I'm going to do them the best I can. And that's all there is to it. And I'm working with beautiful people. I mean, Gillian Hurd and Frank Darabont they gave me so much support. And my friends down in North Carolina that were really truly instrumental in getting me this gig are the Fincannons, Lisa May and Craig Fincannon. They're casting people. We've been friends since Days of Thunder.
And really?
I met them on Days of Thunder. They were not married then, and they're married now. They've been married ever since. And we've been friends, and we're like brother and sister. We love each other dearly. And they came to me and said, dude, this role was written for you. And I got to tell you, I don't see anyone that I can imagine doing it the way you can do it. And I said, well, what is it? You know, I'm like, okay. Like,
he's an asshole and a racist. Yeah. And the thought of you instantly.
Exactly. And get this, he's implied heavily as doing cocaine.
So
exactly, no. But she was talking about, you know, she after I read it, I realized that. But she was talking, Lisa May was talking about stuff like, the how proud this guy is, and how angry this individual is, and we don't know why, you know, he's that way, and it's not written, but it's, you know, it's up to you to bring that to the role. Yeah, I mean, you got to fill it up and so, bring it on, baby. You got to do it. You got to go on set, and you got to be ready to do it. And they knew, and they felt, and they've seen my work in the past, and they know my work, and they felt that I was the guy that would be able to, in real life, take that hacksaw and cut off his leg or arm or
whatever. You're the guy who real life could survive the zombie apocalypse. You're the guy that when the zombies hit, we're going to fly out to L.A. and immediately hold up with you because you obviously know how to deal with it.
Trust me. I mean, that was one of their comments. They were like, if this were to really happen, we would be at your house and hanging out on your coattail behind you. So,
so let me ask you this. Obviously, yeah. I'm sure you do a lot of gigs where you do them and you forget about them and you don't know how big or small they end up being. When did it occur to you that The Walking Dead was kind of a big deal?
Well, I knew it was, you know, when I first read the script, and this was before I got cast, I knew this role was a big deal.
Yeah.
I knew right away, whatever this role, how it's written right now, and this was before the teaser, this was before the 4-minute monologue
thing. Wow.
Okay, this was just number two. That's all I read and that's all I knew about. And to be able to to do that role in a believable way, for me, as I said before, I did it a la carte. I did not do it expecting anything else to come of it. So I did what I did, that little kernel of truth and that I had for this entire run of this thing was this, that's all I have, and that's all I had to hold on to and make believable and make people understand that, yeah, there are people like this. And yeah, there are reasons why sometimes they're like this. And sometimes they just grow up that way. Sometimes they're angry and they're on cocaine and they're addicted personalities and they just are mean people. I don't know why there are people like this in the world, but there are. And so I was proud to have the opportunity to actually try my damnedest to bring, you know, what's on that paper to life, okay? And I was just very, very fortunate to get cast and have this material thrown in my lap and fight. I fought like hell to get it. You know, I did everything possible I could do to get this role, because once I read it, I absolutely, it like struck a chord in me that I got to do this role.
Have you been recognized since the show has come out as Merle Dixon?
Yes, I have.
Really?
Yeah.
Aside from us, of course.
Yeah, it's me and Justin constantly like, holy cow, you're Merle Dixon, aren't
Merle!
You? Say,
Merle!
Are you Merle?
But you know, I have hair. I have a little more hair now, see?
You do.
Usually out here in the sun, I wear a hat or something like that and glasses. But people still recognize me. I haven't had the recognition that I get from, say, of Days of Thunder, or JFK, or Cliffhanger, or something like that.
Yeah.
Because those movies have literally 2-3 generational fan base, and but this is new.
And they've been on cable forever too.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, they've only been seen one time, two times. Well, no, they've been seen a couple of times. But I have a feeling because we only did 6, it's going to be like a Sopranos or a Lost or any of those kinds of things.
Oh my God! No, it's going to be
6 or 7, I mean, or whatever, and they just do them over and over throughout the year. And
I mean, if you look at what Mad Men did from what they did in season 1 to season 2, in terms of how many more people that caught up on DVD or caught up on demand and stuff like that. Walking Dead, I'll tell you what, considering the fact that the number for last week's episode was bigger than the premiere, which was gigantic, it's going to be bigger than network shows next year when season 2 starts, and everybody, it's going to be a snap to catch up. It's going to be a weekend.
Absolutely.
It's going to be a Monday afternoon to watch 6 episodes of this.
Absolutely.
Exactly, yeah. I agree, yeah.
And I'm sure you know it's a good time to bet on cable. Like, obviously, the entire way we consume television is getting different now. Obviously, we buy in wholeheartedly to cable television shows in a way that maybe we don't do with network television shows, and it's so great. Like, there has to be some part of you, as far as lottery tickets go, to buy in on the first episode of a show that ends up being the #1 cable show of all time. There's some part of you that have to be like, all right, this is a good gig, especially knowing that your tenure with it ended with a question mark, and know that there's an opportunity to come back. You had to be
not a question mark, a stolen fan.
Yes.
He's out.
Yes.
And like 14 different narrative elements that were like, no, he lived.
Yes.
No, if you think that maybe he died somewhere along the way, no, he lived long enough just and listen, I'm sorry. People are down there, and if this gets replayed and you're watching this and you're like, oh, no, I haven't watched The Walking Dead, I'm sorry. If Michael Rooker's here talking about The Walking Dead, I'm going to spoil.
Right.
Spoiler alert.
But there has to be some part of you watching that and be like, this looks pretty good. This is a good lottery ticket I bought.
You know what? I think you're right. But it's still got that element of I don't know what's going to happen, and
yes.
That's what I like. That's what I absolutely love. I mean, and that's why I've been in this business so long, because I love that element of I don't know what's going to happen next.
Right.
And I like that with my jobs. I like that with the way I make a living. I really enjoy not knowing when the next gig is coming and what it's going to be, who I'm going to work with. I mean, and I love playing this dark horse. I got to tell you, brother, I love this role. And not being one of the little main group, that's not me anyway. I've never been that way. I've never been part of a group. I've always been an individual. Even in theater, I was asked to join a theater troupe, and I've never been that kind of person. And to play this kind of role, that is not that kind of person. I think that's what my friend Lisa May and Craig Fincannon saw. That it's like, this guy is the dark horse, man, and he's anti-hero, and he's all this kind of stuff rolled into one, and he's dark, and he can be dangerous, and yet, you know what? I think we're going to find some surprises down the road. It's just that, you know, I can't tell you what kind of I kind of know already some stuff, but there's some stuff that I don't know, and I think that's exciting to me. Not knowing what's going to happen, and yeah, this is what a lottery ticket, but I don't know. I don't know what's going to happen with this lottery, you know. I'm not going to be too concerned about it. I'm just going to do what I need to do on the day I need to do it.
You know, let me. I want to get your take on the fact that Walking Dead, I know for the internet culture and for blogs and stuff like Twitter and podcasts like this one and so many others, there's this general frustration. And Brian, you talk a lot about it with Tom on Frame Rate, that there are these shows where geeks like us that play in these playgrounds love, and they get killed and they get, you know, murdered after six episodes, or, you know, we're constantly, you're on petitions saying, no, save the show. This is, you know, this is awesome genre writing. It's a great horror series or sci-fi series. And The Walking Dead was this, like, it was like the geeks team that won the Super Bowl.
Yes.
It was like when all of a sudden those numbers came in and it was like, oh my God, like it's a huge hit.
Yes.
And it seemed like it happened at the same exact time that you had kind of gotten on Twitter with Joe Cambiaggio, but you know, that you were kind of, you had this digital footprint. I mean, what was it, a fun experience kind of being plugged into this community where, I mean, it was like for the geeks, it was like blowing up the Death Star, to use another pop culture analogy.
Dude, I still type with my thumbs and maybe two fingers. But I got to tell you, I'm really digging it. I'm meeting these folks on Twitter and on Facebook, and you know what? I'm meeting old friends. But I'm not only that. I'm just all these new energies that you can sort of get a sense and a feel of this individual from the keyboard and from their tweets, and it's like it's mind blowing to me, because I've never been involved with this part of social networking, and so I'm not I still make mistakes, and every now and then I tweet out my cell phone number and I'm like, whoops, oh, I wasn't supposed to do that.
That any of us, me and Justin included, have done that before, so you're clearly
like. We would be considered by 90% of the populace as experts on these kind of social media.
Oh, good.
And we fuck up constantly.
I've done that too?
Yeah, exactly. No, everybody has. And that's what's great about social media.
Such a dork. Yeah.
Well, no. There's such an honesty to social media, and it allows you to be exactly who you are, and it allows I don't know, an approachability or a level of access that may be unprecedented for somebody of your level of celebrity, where it's obviously you have a real life and there's no way a regular guy can walk up to you and just chit-chat with you and not have it be creepy. But Twitter allows that, and that's something special. That's a unique time that we have because of social media.
I agree. You know what I did a couple times when I was down and I had no money and stuff like that? I have a friend of mine that does these personal appearances in these conventions and stuff. And so I'm like, oh, man, I need some dough. And so I did a couple of them. And I got to tell you, it was like, wow, I got some. I can pay the mortgage now. But I still felt really weird taking money from people for an autograph. And I just felt really weird. And I did two or three of them, and I just said, I can't do any more of these. I you know what? If I could do them and donate all my money to charity or something like that, I would do that. And that's what I'll do in the future, I think. But it was such a joy to be there and to meet people that had been fans of mine since the beginning of Henry. And they're bringing their sons and daughters and their sons and daughters' children.
Yes.
So I'm blown away. I'm just like, this is crazy and this is nuts. And I love meeting these people. And this, if anything, this is the best part of doing these kinds of convention things, because I don't do a lot of them every now and then. I did maybe two or three of them, but it was like so cool. And this is like comes a major second in that. I mean, getting to meet people and getting to talk to people over Twitter and Facebook and stuff like that, fans, and actually saying hi and chilling out with them, you know, just tweeting and chatting just a couple of lines and saying, okay, I got to go, bye, you know, stuff like that.
Yeah, of course. Cool.
I dig it a lot.
Well, and that's huge. I mean, I know for me and Brian, you know, whenever, like when I, you know, was just randomly, and I would have said this no matter what, after, you know, the your first episode on Walking Dead, I'm just like, oh my God, Rooker f-ing killed it. And, you know, I just love to see how they did the Merle Dixon character and everything. And to have you go back and say like, oh no, seriously, like I've wanted to play roles like that before and been told no, I'm like, this is awesome. This is why we invented the internet. Finally.
A guy, I got to tell you, I mean, Cable, we were talking about Cable earlier, and look, Cable is, for an artist, for an actor, it's a godsend.
Yeah,
because
it's changing
the
rules.
We get to say and do things on AMC, for example, for Merle.
Yes.
There is no way. There is no way. My entire career. There's only
you're not going to drop
one,
the N-word on NBC.
Film, there's only one film ever, and that was Mississippi Burning, that the character was ever able to be the real McCoy, the real character, the real thing, like a real, like what
a, if you're gonna play a racist,
somebody in real life
talk like
would
a
say.
Yes.
Do, no?
Yes.
And they don't do that anymore. They can't do it. We're so politically correct that everybody's afraid to write these roles that are either even in love stories and even in a lighter fare, they're still very very picky about how they say it and what they do. But I've never been able to say and be as open and free and honest with the script as I was in the Walking Dead script.
Yes.
I don't think I'll ever be able to do that again unless it's on The Walking Dead. And I got to tell you, The Walking Dead, I hope they don't change, because having the balls to put it out there the way it really is that's very important. You got to keep it real. You got to keep it. And Frank Darabont said that too. You know, everybody's like talking about the script and stuff, and some of these script reads that we'd have a full read through before, like the day before we'd actually start shooting. And some of his last words, almost every time we had these read throughs, his last words were always, keep it real.
in the words of the chat room, they say, yeah, Merle wouldn't say, gosh darn African Americans.
Oh my God. No. And it would have been a shame to have to change those lines. And I would never have said that anyway as that character. I would have had issues with those lines.
Was that super sweet front kick in the script too? Or was that an ad lib? That's totally awesome. That kick was on T-Dog.
Well, you know, once I do that, I was just talking about this just today. Once I do that left hook to Lincoln's to his character, the cop. Once I do that left hook, but I've already punched T-Dog and he's gone back. And then I do the left hook. He's too far away from me to hit. So I asked him to sort of come in a little closer so that I can bring a right cross. But he was still too far away. So I said basically to the director, to Frank and everyone, I said, well, how about if I kick him, you know? And and so basically I do the left cross and then I do a jump snap kick to his chest and to his chin, which worked very well, you know? And I was happy to be able to do that and to do it well.
You were happy to kick him. You were happy to kick a black man is what you're trying to say.
I was totally happy to kick him and he was very happy to take it. And I was very happy that he was not angry with me because I think he outweighs me about 30 pounds. You know? So we choreographed it and I've done a lot of this kind of fight stuff and I got to tell you, no matter how cautious you are, things can still happen.
Yes.
Okay. Somebody leans in when they should have been leaning back, or somebody slips, and all of a sudden you're throwing the punch, and your foot slips out from under you, I'm very fortunate that no one got hurt. No one came away with any injuries. I always count my blessings at the end of fight scenes because I've been in fight scenes where things have gone bad and it's not fun.
Yeah. Well, it's awesome to be the guy who has a reputation for kicking ass. You don't want to be the actor who actually kicks other people's ass is what you're saying, right?
I don't. What do you mean?
Well, I mean, you don't want to physically assault your coworkers, is what I'm saying.
No, I don't. Even when I'm accosted on the street in real life, I still don't want to hurt somebody that much, you know.
Hey, it's actually and first of all, mega thanks for calling us so late on a random night after NSFW. You have no idea how excited we are that you joined us, but we have a special treat for you. Somebody sent in a remix of a song that you had something to do with. You want to hear it as we take this out?
Let's go for it. Let's
hear
it.
Here we go. This is.
I ain't got no panties on.
Hold on.
Got no panties on. on. Got no. Got. Take them panties off. On. Got. Take them panties off.
I'm about to cry.
That is Gal5, GAU5 in the chat room that remixed it, and thank you for him for tweaking it like we asked.
Oh my God!
Can I find that because I want?
Yeah, no, we'll send it to you.
I'll DM it over to you. You're following me on Twitter, right?
Yeah.
Michael,
guys, I love you guys.
Definitely. Listen, everybody, Michael_Rooker, follow the man if you have not done it. People randomly watching us on Justin TV. Not only as you know, I mean, like, listen, Jesus, Herbert Christ, he called our random after
unsolicited. This guy's the real work. He wanted to get in the trenches. He wanted to hear from you guys up close and personal. We, for one, cannot thank enough Michael MFN Rooker of The Walking Dead and a million other movies. Thank you so much, Michael. You're the best.
Thank you guys for having me here, and thanks for picking up the line.
Dude, fantastic. Right. Dude.
It was great to have you on, Mr. Burns. Keep driving.
Later, brother. Yeah.
Take care, dude.
Yeah.
You know what's funny is in my mind, we're performing for only Tony. Like, this is a performance just for Tony Wang. Go ahead.
There's a target audience, and it's you, Tony.
Here we go. On this episode of Tony's in Charge.
On this, a very special episode of Tony's House, Tony has to decide which of the virgin brides will be his first. But meanwhile, he's got to pick up the kids from school. It's another action-packed, wacky episode of Tony's Wang, coming up next.
Coming up on NSFT, not safe for Tony.
All right, here we go.
Hey, can we take a moment? Because Tony's got to watch this. He has to watch this, right?
There's no... Yes, this is his job.
Can the three of us real quick just say how much we appreciate Tony Wang? Tony,
oh, no.
Tony is the original fan of NSFW Inside the Cottage. And if there's enthusiasm, I think it bubbled out from Tony to everyone else. We love you and could not have done it without you, and I love the extra touches you're throwing there. I love the sandwich with the Brian Gerbs in the world. We love what you're doing. We love what you're bringing to everything. Thank you very much. That's all I want to say.
And Tony, thank you for telling me what they do when I haven't caught the show. It's very important.
Right.
I don't
keeping
think
you informed.
I don't think that's a joke.
So do you just get like an NSFW dossier on your on
no, I come in on Wednesdays, and Tony's like, make some like weird comment, and if I've watched the show, I'm like, oh yeah, all right, yeah, I saw that. And if I haven't, I'm like, what did they do? And then he'll explain it to me, and I'll be like, oh, okay, that's pretty good. Don't ever let them do that again.
No. All right, go.